My name is Alex Nasonov. I meant to go to do a dress rehearsal of this talk this morning, but instead I went for a walk from Siegburg because I, in 2003 I walked here and I lived in this town for about an year. And this is my first time back to this town, and I decided to go around and see what changed, what stays the same. And yeah, it's like deja vu because I remember many places. It's, also, I worked at Fraunhofer, and this is when I started doing open source work. And I think around that time I joined Boost. I'm no longer with Boost anymore, but I'm I'm a member of NetBSD team. Also, I wanted to add one more thing. I think FOSDEM started in 2006. And I lived here in 2003, so I missed. Oh, not FOSDEM, sorry, Froscon. So I missed it by just like about 2-3 years. But you know, it's good that we have like that open source is flourishing, and it's there are some interesting trends like going down to FPGA hardware, like formal verifications, all this stuff. I really like what's happening in the open source world. So first of all, I'm NetBSD contributor. I work in the kernel. I wrote BPFGIT. BPF is Berkeley Packet Filter, and this is like low-level bytecode. And this is what you send when you run TCP dump with a filter. It sends a BPF program to the kernel, and the kernel either interpret it or compile it. And I wrote BPFGIT, which is just-in-time compilation for BPF programs with some optimizations. Not many, just some array bounce, check elimination, and some peephole optimizations. Just very simple stuff. But it works on PowerPC, Intel, ARM, MIPS, Spark. Like it's multi-platform, as it should be in NetBSD, because NetBSD is a multi-platform operating system. So also contribute small changes to the kernel, both to the kernel and user space. I maintain some packages because we have package source in NetBSD, which is also multi-platform. You can run it on Linux, on other operating systems. My day job is a C++ developer and high-frequency trading. And I run my own small company, XMM Swap Ltd. XMM for XMM registers. Swap is just like some kind of fictitious instruction which doesn't exist in Intel instruction set. It's mostly C. In NetBSD, I use mostly C, but for my day job is heavily templatized C++. I can go on forever about what's wrong with C++, but it's my topic's about something else. And I do the winner takes it all performance optimizations. I look at assembly every time I write a performance critical pass, I look at the assembly and check what the compilers do correctly, if they make a mistake, and if they make a mistake, how to optimization mistake, suboptimal optimization. I also wrote a DSL mini compiler, which is basically some kind of JSON input with some simple expressions, some dependencies. And I took some existing custom bytecode, which was stack-based, and I used the stack as a register allocator. Also added some vectorization stuff, some small optimizations, I don't use anything like LLVM. I just emit assembly, and I use Dynasme from LuaJIT project to emit assembly. It's like about 1,000 lines of Lua code, which can reprocess your C program and turn some mnemonics into a real assembly binary code. It's quite small, but it's fast. It's faster than doing it in C++. But I'm not a compiler guy because I wrote two JIT or ahead of time compilers, but I only used very few techniques from the compiler theory, just very basic algorithms. So I use GCC 6.3 and newer. Some companies are still stuck in with older versions of GCC, but like version 8 or maybe 7 something, they have some interesting optimizations which I like, but like they all, you know, sometimes they look very sometimes they generate good code, some other times it's not as good, so good in terms of performance. Also Clang, but I mostly use GCC. Clang is good, but like when you need speed, for some reason GCC is a bit faster. So I also tried for this presentation, I also tried CompCert, which is a certified compiler. And I don't do it, I don't use it on a daily basis, but I think it's matured enough to be usable. I was able to compile it on NetBSD, and I was able to run some simple programs, but very simple programs. It's like it has some problems, but I think the NetBSD is specific. Briefly, what is CompCert? It's a formally verified optimizer compiler, and on the website they say almost all of the C99. By almost all of, they mean like they took some safety critical a standard, MISR or something, and follow it. They recommend practices to cover areas which are considered safe, and they target avionics and industries like this. It's not a magic bulletproof. It just it verifies that every optimization pass that is implemented in the compiler is formally verified. So it's formally verified to be equivalent. Like if you go down from a source code, C source code down to generated code, it's all formally verified to be like the generated code is formally verified to be equivalent to the source code. It's multi-platform, PowerPC ARM RISC-V, x86. They claim it's faster than GCC with O0. It's not completely free software, INRIA, apps, int. But you can download it for free and use it for free for non-commercial use. It's quite interesting tool. It's not, it doesn't prove your program. It only proves the optimization inside that, inside the compiler. It doesn't prove that your program is well-defined. And even though I spend most of the time optimizing performance, I thought it would be too dry talk to give to tell you, like spend an hour telling you about how to like shave off one cycle or two cycles from program. And I concentrated on undefined behavior because this is a real problem in C, C++, and I believe it's quite unique to C, C++. Undefined behavior. Yeah, the compiler, the certified compiler assumes the program is well defined. They start, the proof started with this precondition. On the website they use the term triggered, which I liked, because triggered means, even though your program has undefined behavior, it's still roughly the same program, as you intended to be. Like some accidental undefined behavior, and which can be triggered by following some path in your program, and you trigger undefined behavior, and then boom, something happened. In the CompCert, they have a special interpreter which can trigger that undefined behavior. Instead of compiling, you just pass a special flag, and it will interpret your program, and they claim that it can catch undefined behavior. They even have a special flag which explores all possibilities. Like in C, for example, when you call a function and with several arguments, and there's some computation some expressions, non-trivial expressions passed to each argument, those expressions can be evaluated in any order. And I believe that compiler, if you pass that special flag, it will evaluate them in all possible orders. It will only work for very small programs because, it will explode if you pass too many possibilities. Anyway, it's good for spotting undefined behavior. Just Okay, so part one, let's see some assembly. You're going to see some very simple assembly. Like if you attended the previous talk about Ghidra, there were some C programs, some assembly, but you know, I start with the simplest possible, the most trivial C program. It just returns one, and I start with compcert, which it generates a big function body. It has a prologue, epilogue, and the actual function body. And it's on the next slide. You will see a shorter version generated by GCC and Clang. It's just those two instructions. But because compcert is a formally verified compiler, to get rid of those prologues and epilogues, they have to prove, like they have to write some algorithm to eliminate them, and then they will have to prove it's equivalent to the original program, which I assume they don't have time to do. Maybe they do it later. So this is GCC and Clang. They produce good. But let me actually. So this one. So ABI on Intel says the return value is passed in this register EX or IX, and we pass one, and then we return. So if you don't know this guy is awesome. He likes paradoxes, and many of his videos are about paradoxes. For example, mass paradoxes, and I remember there was a video, like 20 minutes long video, about Banachtarsky paradox. It's like when you have a sphere and you separate it and make two spheres out of one. And my kids, who were 6 and 8 years old at the time, they watched it for 20 minutes. So if this guy can keep attention of 6 years old for 20 minutes, it's really good stuff. And he, when he states some. Explain some paradox, and then he goes like, you can't make it any smaller. Then pauses for a couple of seconds, and then he says, oh, can you? So can you make that the previous program any smaller? It's like So what we do here, we introduce undefined behavior by dividing by zero. Surely they generate a warning, but it's a warning. It's not an error. But nevertheless, it has an undefined behavior, which means it can do anything. So GCC, I think prior to 7, it was all kind of the same as normal. So like from GCC 7, it just produces this one instruction, UD2, which is basically building trap, which means that undefined behavior is triggered by just entering the main function, right? This is all good. It's all, this is what we need. Like, undefined behavior triggered immediately, and you can see it by, it crashes loud and clear when undefined behavior is triggered. And next slide is, can you guess what the Clang compiler produces in this case? It's not the same, just this. It doesn't initialize the return value. So as if int main was void main, and this is very subtle behavior, because whatever was in the register prior to the call will be passed to as a return value, and it can if you have a non-trivial program, it may take ages to figure it out, and the best way to figure it out, I guess, is just inspecting assembly and doing reverse engineering, which I do, on a daily basis, just because I need to, shave off some latencies. Okay, sign arithmetic. I think this is the most common source of undefined behavior, and honestly, I think it should have been replaced with a wraparound logic instead, because it's very easy to, like here, n is signed, and we compare it with int mean, and then we do n plus plus. And there will be some wraparound here eventually, because it's a nice trick. You iterate, start iteration from some number until you wrap around, basically. So you want to iterate from starting n to int max inclusively, and as soon as it wraps around, you just exit the loop, right? It's very neat trick, but unfortunately, it's undefined behavior for signed. If it was unsigned and this was something else, then zero there, then you would be fine. But since it's signed, it's undefined behavior, and unfortunately, the compiler take advantage of this undefined behavior by imagining things, I would say. Also, like as a performance, there is also undefined behavior here, most likely because you do signed arithmetic, and this, for most inputs, it will eventually wrap around. And also, signed division by two is less in here is less performant because there is a correction after a shift for negative values. This will be important for some small optimization here later. So yeah, undefined behavior, but fortunately. And unfortunately, current compilers are not smart enough to abuse it fully. But once they get smarter, you will have they will turn some benign behavior here into some, very, potentially very dangerous behavior. Reverse engineered assembly of this function. So GCC just returns this value. It ignores n completely. So if you go back. It knows that by entering the loop, you surely have an undefined behavior in here, and it just skips the whole thing, right? For some reason, Clang is a bit smarter. it knows that for some inputs you don't enter the loop at all, right? So it just eliminates everything from the loop except this condition. So if you enter the loop, you will loop forever. If you don't, then you return ah. So it's a non-trivial, your program runs faster, but it's a non-trivial optimization, very non-trivial optimization. Because your program has undefined behavior, all bets are off. In the next slides, I assume that, just to simplify logic, I assume that n is never equals to int mean, and I just changed the loop, ignoring that special value to avoid. I cannot do n plus plus here, I think, because it will introduce undefined behavior. That's why I do n plus plus after the break. But now it does look as neat as the original code, and I believe it should be wraparound. Like they should do, C should have a wraparound logic. But undefined behavior in the body is still possible here. So if you want to get rid of undefined behavior, you can pass this option, but it enables some optimization, but also disables some other optimizations. And I believe this is why, and historically also, it's not on. Performance numbers. GCC is the fastest. Certified compiler is very close to GCC, and Clang is very slow for some reason. If you like for this program. Zero three, and 0.2 I believe is the same. So for the next slides, I'm going to use.
To execute.
I'll show you the assembly. You will figure. For the assembly, I'm going to use the RADER reverse engineering tool. It can do many things. I invoke it like this with capital O to analyze everything, then go to this to my function, and this one will produce a graph.viz.file with basic blocks of the function, and I just convert it to a PNG file. So this is GCC code. All of it. Some prologue, preamble, and it's quite typical loop. So you have the one basic block for the loop. You compare with some value, and you either exit immediately or enter the loop. And when you're inside the loop, you just do at the end of the loop you do comparison and go back or exit. So here we do correction somewhere. It will be important because CompSort will do it slightly differently. And this is a CompSort code, which have a bit unusual structure because the main loop is not one basic block, it's two basic blocks. And it might be suboptimal for processors, but I believe the reason it's slower, slightly slower, it's because they use conditional move shift correction. You know, for when they divide by two, they use a different code. And I will later get rid of this and the performance will be the same as GCC. So for modern processors, so when I do performance optimizations, last thing I do, I count cycles as like only when I run out of other ideas. So usually a bottleneck is some architectural problem. Like in this case, the bottleneck might be alignment of the main loop, for example. I remember optimizing some code and I was like performance was jumping up and down randomly. And then I realized that one very hot loop was either aligned by 16 bytes or 32 bytes. And this it made a big difference. So Clang unfortunately unrolls this about four times, I think. And this is just the main, like the function body is quite big, and this is just the main loop. And usually unrolling speeds things up, but not in this case. It's like, you know, like 1.5 or more slower compared to GCC. So this here compilers, I'm going to explain how to build a parallel reality. So I start. Like if you start with positive or non-negative n, non-negative r, you can because there is no undefined behavior, it means that there are no wraparounds in here, and this means that you can replace this division by this shift and get rid of the correction, and by doing this, you will your code will run twice as fast, you know. But it's a silly silly performance optimization, but it's like it's very like, you know, it gives you like 100% speed up. So yeah, they never turn negative in our reality. And now it's like, you know, GCC comp sort around at the same speed. Clang is still slower because it still unrolls and it doesn't. But you know, if I did it manually, I would be laughed at. You know, and it was like, you know. But unfortunately, the compiler do it, and it's kind of okay. So my analogy to what the compilers do is a proof by contradiction. The compilers start by assuming, so the compilers kind of want to prove that your program has undefined behavior, and they start by assuming they are well defined, and they try to find the contradiction. But instead of finishing the proof, they can stop at any time. And when they stop at any time, the state of your program is inconsistent because some facts are true facts, but some other facts are made up facts, you know. So yeah, the compilers usually give up and produce whatever is. So here I'd like to finish that the proof or by contradiction for that particular case of non-negative n and r. If n is equal to int max, n is equal to int max on the last iteration. Therefore, it can r by two divided by two can only be zero, means it's less than two. And if you rewind to the previous iteration, you will easily see that it's this is contradiction. It's impossible because int max is big enough to be always false. So yeah, optimized to death function should look like this. Like built-in trap, like this is what GCC does, or just return R for this is what Clang does. Another example. So the previous examples were about signed arithmetic. The other example is from blog post by Krista. Here, the Clang in this particular case uses global analysis to call a function which is never called. Basically, this is static, and it's only visible to this translation unit. And this is the whole program. This is the only translation unit in the program. So this static only visible to the translation unit. This static function also only visible to this translation unit. This can be called from outside, but there is no outside, you know, in this case. And in main, we just call do this one. And it's null, it's a null pointer, but because there is no undefined behavior, Clang assumes that it cannot be possibly null because there is no undefined behavior. Therefore, someone must have called this function from outside. But you know, and it's, you know, the compiler is just one step away from finishing the proof by contradiction, because there is no outside. You know, like it missed just last step of the proof, and they just generated the binary. And it's very wrong because it calls erase all, and this does, you know, bad stuff. This is real. You know, you can go to Godbolt and check it or you know, compile it yourself. I think GCC is better. It doesn't do it yet, but so yeah, this is again Raider 2, and here you see it initializes the first argument to this string. And then it jumps to that system call straight, like, you know, it's main, you know. Main is just like calls the system with this string. Yeah. so.
The compiler cannot figure out that never called is never called, because if it's linked with shared library, I can only preload the library.
Okay, yeah, you're right, yes. Yeah, you're right. So yeah, but you know, in my opinion, they shouldn't do this kind of tricks, because you know, C compilers are fast enough. You know, they, and also the next part. Let me check how much time I have. Yeah, the next part is the death optimizing compilers, because you know, processes got faster, and maybe we don't need you know, like to shave off all. For most use cases, we don't need to shave off all you know, cycles. So Daniel Bernstein gave a talk a few years ago about the death titled "The Death Optimizing Compilers," and you know, briefly, I didn't attend that talk. I read the slides. There are like 300 slides or something. So modern computers are fast. Yeah, I'm not sure. Actually, maybe I made you know, some points are mine, not his points. So modern processors are JIT compilers, because and they're fast JIT compilers. They read a stream of instructions. They can process 4 instructions in 1 cycle, like prefetch. They can prefetch instructions and generate some micro ops code. So they're compilers already. You know, most code is called run only once on startup. Usually it's I/O or memory that is a bottleneck when running cold code, because in order to run a code, you need to bring it from memory to cache, and it takes time, and then you throw it away if you only run it once. But there are some hotspots which are important enough to be optimized. But like people for some hotspots, people do manual optimizations. One example is interpreter loop in LuaJIT. If you check mailing archives of LuaJIT and Mike Paul's post in particular, he explains why his interpreter manual assembly is about twice as fast as C code. Also, Pete Colley looked at one CPython bytecode, look at the code generated by GCC and Clang, and also Visual Studio, I believe. And he suggested some performance optimizations for one particular bytecode, but then he concluded his blog post saying, I'm not going to do it for 100 you know, other bytecodes in Python, but it's possible to optimize Python by rewriting it in highly optimized assembly. Yeah, cryptographic code is often optimized assembly, but not only for performance reasons, also they have other requirements like constant time evaluation, and they don't want the C compilers to insert a branch where they expect a constant time evaluation. Branches means predictions, and this means some timing issues, and this opens a possibility to explore, like to discover bits of your crypto material by just like trying to outsmart the branch predictor, you know, so this kind of tricks. So they, and also I believe some cryptographic code is formally verified, and assembly is actually easier to formally verify because it has like small number of inputs, some effect, and some outputs, also small number of outputs, and they're simple outputs like integers. And it's like easier to build the formal model and also verify some properties of assembly. And I believe there are some formally verified models for Intel assembly and, RISC-V assembly, for example. So this website is full of low-level tricks how to speed up. I also wrote some, like, for example, conversion from string to integer and vice versa. You can easily beat the compiler by just like doing some SSE instead of using general purpose registers and some other stuff. So domain-specific specialized code. People, if code is hot enough, people don't stop at software. They like, and this is some examples of hot code: mass libraries, Atlas Blast, and so on. Regular expressions, Hyperscan is very highly optimized for Intel. Crypto libraries, video audio processing, runtimes, Go, Logit, and etc. Miscode, libdivide is a good example. Check it out. It like it can maybe you know it can help you optimize some code with a division inside. So. As I said, they like don't stop, and they go to hardware, mass libraries. I think in GPU they run on GPU mostly. Password crackers they run everywhere. Software, FPGA, GPU. Sorry? Okay, sorry. Crypto also, you know, mining. I think mining even. Even FPGAs are not fast enough for crypto mining, it's ASICs, silicon. Hardware security modules, also video audio processing, packet forwarding inspection. Okay, other languages. So this, my son plays Minecraft, and one day he told me that he likes Java edition much more compared to this, you know, Pocket edition, almost C++ 11. So why is that, you know, why? Like you don't always need, you know, like the C++. I think you know people believe C++ is faster than Java, but you know for my son, like Java edition is better. So general considerations for bytecode-based languages. Bytecode is like assembly. It has a small number of simple inputs, some effect, and some outputs. Safe languages use bytecode is generally used in safe languages where no undefined behavior, maybe some unspecified behavior or some implementation-specific behavior, but I'm not aware of any kind of abuse of undefined behavior in those languages. And also, I said this already. And when you generate native code like JIT, a compiler, for example, you try to generate a code which is equivalent to interpretation, so you can easily switch back and forth between, you know, interpreter and JIT code. So it, you know, it's supposed to be equivalent. So there is very little space for undefined behavior here because of those constraints. Java, this is based on Stack Overflow, seems to be undefined behavior free from undefined behavior. It has some implementation defined and unspecified behavior, which is different. But they do wraparound for signed arithmetic. Go. This is from Ian Lance Taylor several years ago on Go mailing list. Go has much less undefined behavior than C++. One example is the race condition, signed integer wrapper on Overflow. But yeah, this reduces the scope of loop optimization. But you know, it's good enough for Go. You know, out of bound access. Yeah, panic in a controlled way. Also, shifting by more than width is well defined, and these two have some performance penalty. But again, they are willing to pay this for safety, and I believe safety is more important than. Then raw speed, especially if you abuse undefined behavior. So this one is funny. It's well defined in Go. It's not well defined in C++. On two S complement systems, but you know practically all systems are 2S complements these days. Rust this is from my friend. He said if there is an undefined behavior, it's a bug. I believe Swift. Well, I don't know much about. I want to start looking at Rust, but I even bought a book, but I don't have time. Swift, I believe, is also it's not on the slides. Swift is also safe, I believe. Conclusion. So yes, C++ seems to be driven by opposing forces. Some people come from InfoSec background. They introduce some special code to prevent some stack overflows, to catch some or make it difficult to exploit by, for example, randomizing address space or introducing special checks when you enter a function or exit a function. There are many InfoSec guards available for modern compilers, but they all seem to introduce 1 to 5% slowdown. But if you enable them all, they may add up to quite a significant number. So this one side. The other one is okay. So the other camp is the standard committee and compiler nerds. They want to optimize everything to death, and they don't seem to care about anti-fate behavior, or even they use it to their advantage. And also, I think there is people who try to fix this mess by introducing some sanitizers, for example. And the modern C++ compilers are a mix of people from this camp contributed a bit to harden your compiler. People from this camp contributed a bit to make it faster, and also from the reasonable people, added extra code to catch undefined behavior at runtime. And this, they're pulling the blanket in their own direction, and nothing good can come out of it. Well. So one part of the compiler abuses undefined behavior, but another part might be runtime detection of undefined behavior. And also, I believe for C, there is a list of all undefined behavior in the standard, but there is no list of undefined behavior in C++ standard. I know someone is working on the proposal, but like C++ standard is like thousands of pages of text, and how are you supposed to know all about all undefined behavior hiding in there? And I think that's it from me. There are some links. I think as I said at the beginning, there are some interesting development in formal verification. There is also formally verified KKML ML compiler, and they recently proved it all the way down to hardware on some very slow but verified hardware. This there are some FPGA toolchains, open source toolchains, and there are also some formal verification tools for to check your design. So it's like, I'm going lower level, but that's that's general, my direction of in my career, just like to go down and explore things. I think that's it from me. How much time do we have left? Okay, yeah, that's it from me. Yeah. In here.
Yes, because there's a reason for my question. Because
yeah.
The IEEE floating point format, there's a reason for my question. If you use floating point, there's a representation and known for undefined and infinite number.
Yeah.
Zero divided by zero is not undefined, but not the number at all.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah. The
for example, compare an undefined against another undefined is also undefined.
Yeah. Yeah, those examples have nothing to do with floating point, because there is no floating point.
Yes, but the floating point, the IEEE has set some rules decades ago, which explain why, what's the correct way of arithmetic with those type of numbers.
Yeah, but for floating point numbers, not for integers, not for signed integers.
Yes, but many of the problems are very similar, I think.
Similar?
So, yes.
No, I would say a floating point is very different. And when I wrote the DSL compiler, which I mentioned at the beginning, it uses floating points, and it made certain things simpler, because or even simpler than if you like in if you use GCC, you can pass FastMath, which violates some of those requirements from the standard, IEEE standard. But because I generate code and it uses floating point, it's all well defined. I follow that.
Yes, that was the goal of the IEEE floating point. And they have developed methods for dealing with those cases which are undefined. And that's the point. You can transfer some of those methods, not all of them, of course. You could, and the compiler guys could do that.
Yeah, they could do it, yeah. But
and I think this is lacking.
Yeah, but you know, I'm not a compiler guy. I'm just telling you what's wrong, which, in my opinion, what's wrong with the...
the problem has been all treated some decades ago.
Yeah, but you know, if you switch to floating point for those examples, they will run like five times slow or something, because you know floating point.
Yes, it's clear that floating point is a different application area, but the principal laws behind those undefined behaviors are mathematical ones. And
yeah, but hardware behind floating point is very different compared to hardware behind,
the implementation is different, of course, but the concept is
you deal with concrete hardware, not with the concept when you write programs. But on Intel, it's I know Lua prior to 5.3 used only floating points for everything. Like if you do a loop, it's going to be floating point. They introduced a subtype to speed up applications which don't need the floating point. But yeah, there are some languages which based on floating points. They don't use integers for numbers, and it makes certain things simpler. Even if they use integers, like they code is generic enough for the compiler not to be able to figure out there is undefined behavior, because undefined behavior happens when you run a bytecode, and bytecode is generated by compiling or running some program, and the compiler cannot predict which program are you program in the scripting language you're going to run. So it's much less scope for undefined behavior in those languages. Some stuff can be converted to use floating points, and this will help. As I did in the past, I just write assembly, and it's well defined.
You know? I have an example. Your very first example, where it's just the red instruction was the only compiler result. I think this is wrong, even in integer, because
this is what the undefined generated.
Yeah, you had an example in a very early slide.
Yeah.
1 divided by 0, and this is the same with integer or with floating point. There's no difference. Yes. Yes. Yes, and that's the point. Yeah, that. Yes. Yes, you cannot handle it in the representation, but the compiler can compile it. It's a constant evaluation here, and the compiler could handle it in this case, but it doesn't. That's the point here.
I can run.
1 divided by 0 is a constant expression. Whether it's integer or whether it's floating point, it does not matter. Yes, but the result I saw is probably wrong. Because the result isn't in actual execution is not a representation like in floating point, but the difference is it is something different from what is a random number on the stack.
GCC compiler does DFSD here. So I switch to floating point and it does DFSD. So it loads one constant into XMM from this location relative to instruction pointer to this address. And then it divides, and I believe this is where the zero is stored. Yeah. So, okay. Okay, this is clunk. So, which behavior do you prefer? I prefer the GCC. So.
Another question, based on your experience so far, looking into the future, do you...
Oh. Based on your experience so far, in the future, do you think that there will be a stop to this compiler smarts, or it will just continue being more and more esoteric to a point where you will not be able to compile something from a year ago because the compiler now throws half of the code away because it decides you're never going to need
that? Yeah, I think this the trend will continue. Maybe you know C++. I think. You know, this, we have enough languages and the processes are fast enough. In my opinion, we should move away from C++ for most workloads and maybe only use C++ in the kernels, for example. I think the trend will continue for a while. I'm not sure how much smarter the compilers will get, but surely they will break some programs. And I know I couldn't find the link, but there was a real security problem in Bind, I believe. Where just by compiling by a newer compiler, there was some you could exploit it, and so there was a security problem in the if you compile with the new enough GCC, and I believe this will continue. We will probably see some examples of like subtle behavior turning into aggressive behavior, or you know. I came across several posts. I was surprised how many bugs were found by if you look at us assembly that were undefined behavior. I found like at least five, and I remember coming across some blog posts or even two blog posts. So I wouldn't surprise it if it's the same. Issue, but like there are many issues. There are sanitizers, and recently we added in NetBSD we added a bunch of sanitizers, and one sanitizer prints a warning about any undefined triggered undefined behavior. I see commits almost every day fixing those undefined behaviors, like shift by too much or assigned. Signed overflow, these kind of things. But unfortunately, they don't catch all undefined behavior, and they only catch undefined behavior which they can find at runtime. You have to go a particular path in your program to catch them. And with advanced compilers, there is no more, in some cases, there is no more triggered undefined behavior, because if they can turn loop into just plain return, how can you trigger undefined behavior? I believe in this particular case, they just, well, hopefully they print a warning, but I don't think it's possible for all programs to be accurate about finding undefined behavior. But anyway, yeah, I think this has to stop, in my opinion. Okay.
I think there have been several proposals to remove some of the undefined behavior, let's say hotspots, from C++. Do you know about the status? I think there was one that signed integer overflow should be 2's complement. And another one was about order of evaluation, which is also kind of a historic source of this problem.
Yeah, I'm not sure people will agree on. So like committee is like some independent, people from various companies from multiple vendors like Visual Studio, some other compilers, and they all do things differently. And how do we make them agree on this thing? If someone will have to change the compiler, who is it going to be? I'm not sure that this they can solve all the problem. But another thing which I forgot to mention, this guy is preparing a list of undefined behavior in C++, and he's on Twitter, and he recently tweeted some undefined behavior which in the programs that can be both C and C++. You can compile it as C and C++, but undefined behavior is different in C compared to C++. It's like complete madness. Yeah. I know, when I see people, like, you know, sometimes interview people and I see someone put C, C++, I ask them about obvious differences when you code, when you write a program in C, which is also can be run as C++, and ask them, like, what are the differences? But this guy is the next level. He knows the differences and undefined behavior. Like, you know, in C, enum is always, enumeration type is always int. In C++, it's based on a range of values, like this kind of things. But this guy knows about, you know, differences in undefined behavior. So it's, yeah, and also this adds up to complexity of C++ compilers, because some part is C compiler, and it shares a lot of code with C++ compiler, and then they have those differences. I don't know how they deal, how people who write compilers deal with those kind of, like, you know, those problems pile up, and after 3 decades or, I don't know, 4 decades of compiler development, like, you can imagine how many layers you have there. Yeah, that's... Any more questions? I think we have 10 minutes left. I wanted to talk more about performance optimizations, but it's like would be too dry, as I said. But there are lots of architectural artifacts in compilers which affects performance. But does it really matter? Well, in some cases it matters, but in most cases it doesn't. Yeah. Okay. That's it from me. Thank you.